Good evening. Welcome to another Monday night lecture here in Queens. We'll speak about the upcoming parasha, Parashat Vayigash, maybe some current events. We're still in the middle of the story in Yosef and his brothers, as we finished Parashat Miketz. As if you remember, last week we finished explaining that Yosef is actually, in reality, the strongest person that ever lived in this earth, financially. He controlled all the money in the world for 80 years, from age 30 to age 110. 80 years. Nobody in history had such power. Think about it. You have 7.5 billion people today. Add all the generations before. Who knows, maybe, 15, 20 billion people. And he reached the highest level. And this upcoming parasha is very dramatic. It would make a very nice movie in Hollywood. A real drama. Probably sell many millions of views. The problem with this is that when we learn Torah, there are two ways to learn. It's the ordinary way, that people that don't know anything from their life, that's how they learn. And there is a way to learn the way you should learn. Like a serious learner, Talmid Yeshiva, Talmidei Chachamim. There's two different angles to learn. As we're going to see soon what I'm talking about. There's a chain of events, very dramatic, happening in the house of Yaakov from the time Yosef is gone. 22 years of suffering. And we see that the brothers arrive to Mitzrayim. They try, they get some food. There's no food. Hashem is preparing the preparation of the Jewish people to go to slavery in Egypt, as he told Avraham Avinu. Are we going to be in a nation, in a country, and we're going to be tortured by them, and then later we would live with some wealth. Lots of wealth. And we see that after the dreams and after Yosef is prepared enough money for 7 years, wine, fruits, barley, wheat, all grains, rice probably, everything that a person needs to survive, now he goes into a process of basically occupying the whole world financially. Gets to the point that the people that have nothing left, they have to mortgage their homes and their fields. And he makes a deal with them that he takes everything they own to the ownership of power. And he let them continue to work for 20%. Basically, we see the foundation of the IRS is in this parasha. The idea of collecting taxes on income from people, this is the source of it, right here. And also, the idea of giving a tax exempt to religious organization is also in this parasha. We learn from here that Yosef dismissed the religious people, all the Kohanim of Avodah, the people that in service, dismiss them from paying this 20%. He gave them all kinds of benefits. Why? They understood the importance of their religion in a country. But the idea that he would let the people stay and work in the fields and they will have to pay him 20% because I'm the owner of your field. You mortgage the field to me. But the problem is how you going to ensure that the field is really going to be yours? If you let the people stay there, if the bank wants to repossess the house of someone who did not pay his mortgage, so the bank wants to take away the house. If the bank would let him live there for a few years, the bank lose their power. Because this person come to the court and say, I have possession, I'm living here for years. They never kicked me out. That's it, it's my house. It's back again to be my house. So what do you do? Legally, it's called something like this, called chazaka. In America, you need to be in a property 7 years and no one protests against it, and then it becomes yours. That's it, they cannot kick you out. If you live there, nobody protests. The original owner of the place never came, never demonstrated, never called the police, never filed any lawsuit against you. That means no one claimed for the ownership of the property. But if people protest and you refuse to go out, that's not giving you any chazakah. In the Torah, you don't need 7 years, 3 years. 3 years. If 3 years nobody comes and demonstrate, and you live there, or you took over the field, and you grow some vegetables there, or wheat, barley, and no one comes and stop you, no one makes a filing against you, nothing like that, then automatically, that's it. It's considered yours. Same thing if people walks on your property. If people cut from your home, they have a shortcut. They walk on your property, and they do it for 3 years, and you did not stop them, you did not make a fence, you did not protest, you did not scream, I don't give you permission to pass by. After 3 years, there's nothing you can do about it. That's it. The property already become a public property. In English, it's called easement. Sometimes you buy a property, and a part of your property belongs to the town. For instance, they have a sewer there of the neighborhood in your backyard. If they want to get access to that place, if one day that it's blocked, there's nothing you can do. I have in my backyard, one of these covers in metal. Baruch Hashem, they never needed to come. But if one day, God forbid, something happened, they can come with a truck. They don't need my permission. They come with their truck into the back, open it up, go inside. There's nothing you can do. You can scream, hey, what are you doing here? I didn't give you permission to go. Why? That's called easement. It's enough that you have a little piece of your property. That's it. If you let people pass by, after 3 years, there's nothing you can do about it. That's why many people, they put a sign, no transparency. This little sign that they put, it's actually protesting. So if one day he wants to close, he wants to put a gate, the people say, well, you cannot block the shortcut here. What is this? We're walking here for years. So I never gave you permission to walk. There is a sign right here, no transparency. You actually broke the rules by stepping on my property. You cannot stand here with a machine gun every day. You have a sign. If you walk, you are breaking the law. But if there's no sign, there's nothing you can do. 3 years, that's it. Once 3 years you did not stop it, there's nothing you can do. But in the civil law in America and in some other countries, it's 7 years. 7 years, if you did not protest and people walk on your property, there's nothing you can do after that. There's big nafkamina la halacha. There is a lot of interesting things coming out of it. I'll give you an example. If someone knocked down from a plane a box of lots of gold and diamonds and it fell in your property, who's the owner of it? As soon as it hit the ground in your property, it became yours, officially. So if you're not there, your field, your property, buys it for you and makes you the owner. Once it touched the land that you own, it becomes yours. That's only if you're interested to buy it. For instance, if it's a case of beer, landed with a parachute, into your backyard in the middle of Pesach. You're not interested to buy this chametz in the middle of Pesach. So if somebody hates you, he throw a bottle of beer into your backyard and makes you the entire Pesach violating three sins from the Torah. Every second, bal yirae, bal yimatze, and tashbi to seor mi batechem. All you have to do to someone you hate, just put a piece of bread in his backyard and it's done. Two million sins in 1 week or more is going to make. That's not going to work, because the only way you buy it is if you're interested to buy it. If it's gold, silver, something valuable, something that you really want, officially become yours. However, so if you're not there, let's say you're not home, you went away, and it fell right in your backyard, and your neighbor saw it, and he knows you're not home. And he comes on your property and take the gold and the diamonds, that's 100% stealing. He actually stole it from you, you the owner, even if you didn't know about it. חצרו של אדם קונה לו שלא מדעתו. The field, the property of a person makes a kinyan, buys it for you, even when it's not, you are not aware of it. That's the rules. So now, what happened if it would fall exactly on the path that people walk on your property for 10 years already? This box of gold and silver and diamonds landed with a parachute. Now, if it's going to go right, it's going to land in your backyard. No one walks there. But what happens if there is a path that you allow people to walk and it's going to fall right on that path? And now one person who walks on your property, usually they walk there every day, he got lucky. It fell right in front of him. And he picked it up and took it. Was he allowed to take it or no? Yes. Allowed. Why? Because it became the property of the public. Like he found it on the street, even though it's in your backyard. Same thing if you go to a store. If somebody lost a diamond ring in a restaurant, let's say you go to the Chinese restaurant, takeout. You stand by the counter, you look at the floor, you see a diamond ring. The store owned by Mr. X. Mr. X saw that you just picked up the diamond. He's been from the other side of the counter. So, wow, I got so lucky. 2-carat diamond. And he said, no, no, not so fast, my friend. I'm the owner of the store, and my property, buy it for me. Someone lost it here. It belongs to me. Is right or wrong? Right or wrong? Logically, it should have been right. But it's wrong. Why is wrong? Because everything from the counter inside belongs to him. Because it's a private territory. Everything from the counter outside, that's the public territory. People go in and out all the time. He's made it hefker. He allows people to walk there for years. So from here on, whoever is going to find it on the floor, it becomes his. You understand? And this is, of course, I'm not talking about taking it to himself. He still needs to make an announcement. If somebody lost it, if it has signs in it, he can describe it, put notes in the synagogues. I found glasses. Whoever is going to come and give description will take it. It also depends if the majority of the people are religious Jews or not. If you lose something in Monsi, you never give up, because you know, most of the people over there are religious, almost everyone. And religious people return what they find. If they see there is a sign in it. If you have a bottle of water, there's millions like this. It's very difficult to give a sign. But if you have a specific book, you have your name, telephone number on it, or you marked it with yellow marker, so you can give description what you lost. If you call, I heard you found a book. Yes, it's mine. Yeah, I give you some signs. Inside, I mark like this. One page is missing. 2 pages are ripped. Okay, now we know it's his. So in a place that the majority of the people are religious Jews, if you found something, the person did not lose hope. Why? Because he knows that somebody will contact him and return it. Because he never gave hope, you cannot enjoy from it because he never let go. In his conscious and his subconscious, he never let go from the item. But if he lost it in Manhattan, Fifth Avenue, millions of people there, who knows who's walking there. A minute after he lost it, he found out he lost it, that's it. You already know, you'll never find it. So if you find it, it's yours. You don't have to search for the owner. Why? Because the owner gave up. It's called Yeush. Yeush. Yeush means desperation. He's desperate, that's it, he gave up. So, going back here, Yosef, now after he made the entire property of the people around Egypt and in Egypt belongs to Paro, he allowed them to use it. But how is going to overcome this easement problem that people would not come back and say, hey, I'm sorry, we own it again. You let us stay. That becomes ours. What did he do? He moved them out. He started to move them out. He moved him to this field and he moved him to that field. He did not keep them in one place. The owners of the house had to go to a different field. And the person from the other field moved to another field. Meaning, it's like rent. I'm renting you the place. You don't stay in a place that you live for 20 years to prevent people from coming and say, he never took it away from me. He allowed me to stay here legally. What happened? One day Yosef will die. They're going to come to court in Egypt and say, he never took us out. He allowed us to stay. This is, we only had to pay him commission. That's it. No, it's not commission. It's you working for me as like a manager, and I'm giving you 20% commission. I'm giving you, but that's my property. So basically, he made Paro the richest person in history and owned basically the whole world. Why? When people don't have what to eat. Out of desperation, they'll give everything they have just not to die. So this is it. This is the connection between the last parasha and this parasha. Now comes the drama. What's the drama? Let me give you first a little preview and then we'll start highlight some of the things that we can learn here. In the last parasha, Yosef decreed that Binyamin will stay. Binyamin, you know, they hid the silver cup in his belongings. And he said, the one that we will find my silver cup in his belongings, he will remain here and stay my slave. Not all of you. And he let them go. Obviously, it's all a plan here. Yehuda comes to Yosef. He says, let me tell you something. I want you to consider it. If I speak hard to you, please don't get upset. We came to Egypt to buy food. You ask us all kinds of intimate questions. That is none of your business. Obviously, you have something personal against us. Obviously. Well, why would you care about our family? You're asking all these personal questions. We come to buy food, give you money, let us go. What's all these games and tricks? But we still did not hide anything from you. We told you about our old father. We told you about the son that he had when he was old already. We told you about the other son he had that died. You asked us to bring the youngest boy. We brought him. We told you that we cannot do it. He can die like his mother, like his brother. You insisted that we should bring him. Otherwise, we cannot come again to see you. We told this to our father. He said, my wife gave me two boys. One was eaten, and the other one can also die. But we left him no choice because of the hunger. He was forced to agree. Now you want to keep this boy Binyamin by you. We cannot go back to our father without him. Why? Nafsho keshura benafsho. Their soul is connected well, the father and the boy. We cannot separate them. Yehuda continue. Yehuda is the king. Yehuda is the leader of the brothers. So he's the speaker of the house. Yehuda say, when my father will see that Binyamin is now with us, he will die from sorrow. If you ask me, why I am the one who debates you more than my other brothers, the answer is because I took personally responsibility on Binyamin, or I would lose my share in this world and in the next world if I won't return him to my father. So my offer to you is, take me instead of him. Take me instead of him. I'm better than him in everything. I can work harder, I can fight better, and I can serve you better. He's young, he's not going to give you so much of a service. But I cannot go back to my father without Binyamin, seeing him suffering. Now this speech that Yehuda gave is very critical. Who can tell me why? Why we learn from this speech? What does Yosef care about all this? If you stand in front of the judge, you're going to tell him all these stories, all these things, this, my father, upset, what does he care? There's something in the story here that works very well on Yosef. What is it? Yeah?
He doesn't want to cause sorrow to Yaakov. It's the biggest sin he can do.
No, that's not what I mean. I mean, obviously we know everything he said to Yosef, I already said it. One of the things, he doesn't want to upset his father, but what is the message we learn from this speech? What is the message that Yosef gets from this speech after 22 years that he have not seen these brothers? That Yehuda, who's the one who sold him to the Goyim, to the Arabs, Yehuda is the one who said, why should we kill him? Get him out of the pit, let's sell him to the Goyim. Back then, he did not care about the pain of Yaakov. He's the one who took the alphet and put it in the blood of a goat and say to him, do you recognize it? And that's when Hashem did it to him. That Tamar told him, do you recognize this stick and the stamp? Midah keneged midah. He said to his father, do you recognize it? Tamar said to him, do you recognize it? It's all connected. Yehuda now learned the lesson. What's the lesson? 22 years ago, when we had a similar case now between Yosef and Binyamin, I didn't care. So I came to the father, I broke his heart, but it didn't bother me so much. When my brother went away and we knew that we would probably never see him ever again, we also were not so bothered. We sat, we ate, everything was fine. Now Yehuda, he learns his lesson. First, he thinks what's going to happen to Yaakov. Second, he offered, take me. If I have to die for him, I'll die for him. So that's very, very good, because now he sees, if Yehuda wouldn't care about Binyamin, okay, listen, what can we do? You want to keep him? Keep him. Nothing was learned after 22 years. The same easy way you let me go and you didn't care about me, you do the same thing to my brother. Then the end of the story would be totally different. It wouldn't be a happy end. Remember, all this conversation between Yosef and them, and all the tricks he does to them, is actually investigating them, an FBI investigation, with all kinds of tricks, to see, did they fix who they are or no? That's what it's all about. Why it's so important that a person will fix who he is or not? I'll give you an example of what I'm talking about. The Gemara say, Rabbi Yehuda HaNasih, one time the calf came under him, the calf, they were slaughtering the calves there. He was on the way to be slaughtered. And Rabbi Yehuda HaNasih pushed him and said, go, you were made to be eaten, basically. So what are you coming to me to hide? He pushed him away. And then right away he got stones in his kidney. For so many years he was suffering. 14 years he was suffering. 13, 14 years, screaming, pain. The pain was so strong that when he was screaming, he asked his servant, he was very rich, he had a lot of servants, and he said, serve food to the horses Because when horses see food, they begin to scream. They make a lot of noise. That's when I begin to scream, right away put food by the horses. Because when the horses make noise, people outside won't hear me screaming. It breaks the heart of the Jews passing by that the chief rabbi of Israel that wrote the Mishnah and is the most important person in the world right now, that he suffered pain and scream. So I don't want to upset the people. Make the horses scream that people don't know that I'm under attack. Similar to when you take your kids for pizza or shawarma in a restaurant, how they are. How they scream for this, fighting for that, fighting for the ketchup, fighting for the drink. You know, very difficult for kids, even adults, to see food and stay calm. Needless to say, the horses. You put food in front of the horses, forget about it, what noise you get. So what happened? So 13 years he's suffering. Every year he does slichot, he prays. Every Monday and Thursday is slichot. Every night he does vidui. 40 days slichot from Rosh Chodesh Elul to Yom Kippur. 13 years Yom Kippur, learning Torah all his life, giving tons of tzedakah. Such a big tzaddik, such a holy person. The pain is there for 13 years. When the pain went away, when he saw the maid is sweeping the floor and the little mice, she make the mice fly away with the broom. And he said to her, hey, why don't you have mercy on these mice? Verachamav al kol ma'asav, Hashem have mercy on every creature he made. Why don't you have mercy on these mice? So that day, the pain went away. He didn't need MRI, no laser, none of these things. Didn't need special health insurance, emergency Medicaid, none of these things. No pharmacy visits, nothing. What? Pain went away automatically. Why? Because the pain comes from Hashem. And the pain comes because of the way we behave. And the way to take it is to fix the reason why it came. That's what the Torah teaches us. So now, same thing over here. Yehuda can give him a lot of beautiful speeches. That's not impressive. I want to see if you change who you used to be. The things that did not bother you back then, right now, bothers you or no? Would you die for your brother now to protect him? With me, it wasn't like this. Would you care about your not to break the heart of your father? I want to see. The answer so far, yes. But it's not enough. Let's move on. It's very hard for Yosef to continue with his act. But he also doesn't want to embarrass his brothers in front of the Egyptian. So he asked all the guards to go out. Now we know that Yehuda is very, very powerful. You give him one smack, he kills him on the spot. So he takes a very big risk. Chazal say that Yosef did something very foolish. What? By letting all the guards going out, he actually exposed himself from a much dead situation. They could have killed him, get out, kill a few more guards and run away with Binyamin. But Yosef said, it's better to die than to embarrass people in public. I don't want to embarrass them in front of all these Egyptians. Similar to what Tamar did with Judah. Do you recognize it? If yes, yes. If not, I'll die and I won't embarrass you. So this is a little bit of a preview of what happened so far. Now let's see. Vayigash elav Yehuda. Yehuda comes to him. Amar Rav Simon. In the law, the book of law of the nation of Israel, meaning the Torah, it's written, if someone stole, and right now he was caught, and he has not enough to pay back. Nimkar begnevato. You sell him to be a slave. To who? Who are you selling him to? No, not necessarily. Shimon stole from Reuven. Reuven asked from Shimon, pay me back, I don't have. Police come, arrest this Shimon. Now what do? They sell him to be a slave. They sell him to be a slave. Once he's a slave, he has rights. Now I want to ask you a question. What kind of a punishment is this? If you already know this guy is a thief, do you want him in your house? Today you have cameras, all kinds of security measurements. Back in time, you're going to have to watch him every second. You cannot leave him a minute in the house. And you know he's a thief. The next thing he's going to sell, steal this and steal that. Every time you're not home, he's going to steal something and run quickly and sell it. Who wants to bring a thief into his house? Someone who just came out of jail was convicted by stealing. What does the Torah want us to do? I don't get it. Where is the logic here? It's very stupid to take a thief and put him in jail. So far you had a thief, now you have a murderer. Or you had a small thief and now he became a real con artist in jail. He learned from the big sharks. Plus, it doesn't help the people that lost their property. How does it help me if they put the thief in jail? Does it help me in any way? Doesn't help. So the secular punishment is very stupid. But let's try to be honest. The punishment of the Torah is any better? Taking the thief into your house? What's good about this? So the answer is, we want him to feel horrible. Look at you, you're a thief, and we're now taking care of you. I'm eating steak, I'm letting you eat steak. I sleep in a good bed. I got you the same bed. So you feel horrible. Because one of the ways to educate a person is to do things for him that he doesn't deserve. That's a very big punishment for him. I'll give you an example. If you have an enemy that you know he speaks bad about you, and you now saw him in a wedding or on the street, you went to some place and you found your enemy knowing he speaks non-stop against you. There are three ways to handle it. One way is to begin to attack him and rebuke him. Shame on you. You are ungrateful. You chatzuf, lashon hara. You have no share to the world to come. That's one way. Second way is to just break a chair on his head. Or worse than that. Which, you know, you're going to end up in jail. If you cannot control your temper. And what's your temper? And what's the third way? To run to him and shake his hand. Avi, how are you? I'm so happy to meet you. Which one of the three kills him the most? The third one, because he cannot look at your eyes. Try it. See how he moves his eyes to the side. He cannot look at you. Because just an hour ago, he was murdering you with his mouth. And you look in his eyes with such smile. How are you? Wow, I'm so lucky to meet you here. How you been? How's your family? It kills him. Usually, besides the shame that he has, after you go, that's better than 5 hours of rebuking him. Because he feels so horrible now. Look at me, what a low life I am. Such a nice person. How he treats me nice, and I've been speaking about him all this time. He feels horrible. So immediately he goes back to these people. You know, actually, what I told you, it wasn't so, you know, it's not so true. But if you come and say to him, shame on you, Rasha, you should die, you should burn in hell. What do you think will happen tomorrow? He will double his lashon hara against you. The only problem is that the third shita requires humility. And we don't have it. That's the problem. We're full of ego. The ego here is the killer. If we were very humble, it would not bother us to run to somebody that speaks against us and shake his hand. The problem is our ego. Just today I saw something unbelievable. There's a case in Israel. A grandmother passed away, and she inherited There's all the grandchildren. Most of her children already passed. But there are a lot of grandchildren, like 15. So they are dividing her house between 15 people. So two people wanted to sell their share to somebody. That somebody, it's already 3 months in negotiation with the two grandchildren that wants to sell their share. The interesting part is that after he did all the job, prepare all the documents, the contracts, back and forth, fixing everything, after all of that, getting all the proper documents from the government, all the tax papers, you know, you have to, there's so much to sign, you know, sign here, sign here, sign here. If you've ever been in closing, you know what I'm talking about. You have to sign the whole Tanakh. After all of that, the lawyer of the buyer called him in Hebrew, Ata Chaper, two lawyers. One lawyer insulted the other one. Chaper means you're not professional. You don't know how to be a lawyer. He had to see how he reacted. He did not bother him to let go of the case 1 day before the signing, that he gets his money for all the job he was doing for the last 3 months. Because of one word he told him, I don't want to deal with him. He's calling me Chaper, and I'm going to show him. I don't want anything to do with this deal. Find a different lawyer. But we almost finished everything. We don't want to start everything again. No, it's okay. I don't want money. Take it. It's done. You just need someone else to come to the closing. He's willing to give up 3 months of work and headache. And in Israel, it's double headache than here. Here, it's a lot of headache. In Israel, it's double or triple headache. So much to deal with by bureaucracy. That's just for one word, ego. Look at the ego of a person. No, I don't care about the money. If somebody asks you what people love more, honor or money? How do you know if you have more pride than greed? Somebody asks you, what are you more, proud or greedy? Proud. Assuming you are both. You have high ego and you have high greed. How do you know which one you have more than the other? They're both horrible traits. How do I know if I'm more greedy or more proud? That's a perfect example. If I'm willing to give up money for my name and reputation, then I am more proud than greedy. But if the money is more important than my honor and my ego, meaning I'm going to put my ego down because I'm going to lose a lot of money if not. I give you an example. If a customer abuses you, you own a store, you own a shoe store. This customer abuses you, annoy you, make fun at you, but in the end he buys a lot of good shoes. Every month he comes and does shopping in your store. Make me coffee. Don't talk when I talk. Don't you see I'm on the phone? He treats you like a dog. You're the owner of the store. But he leaves $1,000 every time he comes. And you keep up with his insult. You are more greedy than proud. But if you are more proud than greedy, you tell him, listen, this is the last time you come into this store. I don't want to see your face here ever again. Why? I'm not a good customer. You're a good customer. Go to your grandmother. Buy over there. So now what are you? Your ego is more important than greed. You understand? Remember the story I told you about Shmuel? Shmuel, you remember or no? You already forgot about Shmuel? Shmuel what? Shmuel was the Jewish, from Jew. Shmuel in Yiddish is Shmuel. Shmuel. That was selling milk in Israel 60 years ago, 50 years ago. With bicycle, three wheels. There's the front, you have a cart, one wheel in the back. They used to bring glass bottles of milk, fresh, from the cows, every morning to sell it to the workers. You give them the old bottle of yesterday, and he gives you a different one. Exchange. That's how it used to be. It wasn't like today, pasteurized milk in boxes, 1 week on the shelf. No. One time, there was a hot day. By the time he came, the meal got spoiled. So the next day, when he came again, one of the diamond cutter that was working with my father spilled the milk from the window on his head. Only in Israel you have things like this. When this Shmi looked up, he saw the face of the worker, and the other workers from the window are laughing. It became a show. I don't have to tell you how fuming he was. He started to run upstairs, and this worker realized he's going to kill me now. I just spilled the milk on his head. What was going through my head? My father took out a coin of a lira. Back then it was good money. He said to him, don't worry, with money you solve all the problem. As soon as this Shmil walked in, Efu, where is he? My father said to him, Shmil, here, this is for you. Leave him alone. He looked at the money. It's a very big challenge now. Ego versus money. His anger, which is the ego, versus the money. Now we're going to know which one is more. More greedy or more standing on his name and reputation and kavod. He took the money and the anger was gone. Same thing, I once went to a store to buy shoes. The woman over there was screaming at someone on the phone, fuming, screaming, cursing. As soon as I walked in, I have to go. Hi, how are you? How's your day? I was standing by the window listening how she's ready to explode. Her love for money overcome her anger and ego and honor and the rest of the thing. But sometimes people would lose $1 million for the ego. Remember the story I told you that I almost bought a house in Monsey from criminal lawyer Rasha Merusha? That everything was finished. He said, you have until Monday by 5 p.m. to submit the check with the 10% to my lawyer. And I was on my way there 5 to 5. On the way to his agent. And the real estate agent, she called, where are you? On my way to submit the paper. Oh no, the deal is off. She was crying. Big commission. I said, why the deal is off? I told you I'm going to submit the paper. I'm on my way to give it to him. No, but he told you it's by 5. He just called me now. The paper were not submitted. No deal. His ego. Until today, he didn't sell the house. 17 years already. But I got saved. Instead of buying this garbage home, which was 40 years old, with some nice cosmetic, I ended up buying a house double on the side, brand new. For a little bit more money, very little. Why? Hashem, you know, saved me from being blind. When you're under pressure, you make mistakes. But here is an example of a person that his ego is so high, he doesn't mind to lose a buyer because you didn't do it my way. I don't need your money. Cancel it. That's it. This is the challenge between those two. So what's going on now? So the Gemara say, if you don't pay, you have to be sold to be a slave. The Magid Miduvna, that was 200 years ago, in the time of the Gaon Mivilna, he said, Yuda is trying to explain to Yosef something. What is it? You don't want Binyamin as a slave. You don't want to keep him as a slave. Why? He said, usually, why thieves steal? They don't have. They don't have food. They don't have to buy themselves a warm coat. They ended up going to a place they're jealous that everyone has and they don't have and they steal. Ganav shenitpas bechet ve'en lo ma leshalem. If he doesn't have money, obviously he's poor. If he had money, he would pay. He wouldn't become a slave for 7 years now, 6 years. So now when he works, he actually pays back to the one he owes the money. So Yehuda said to Yosef, why would a person want a thief in his house? It will hurt him again. No? But we know that a person, most people, logically, they don't have such an urge to be thieves. If they have what they need, most likely they won't go into stealing. Most likely. If a person went to steal, that means he feels that he doesn't have enough. He doesn't have emunah in Hashem, and he runs to steal. Yehuda say, but that's only about a regular thief. But this boy, Binyamin, my brother, we all come from a very wealthy family. My father is very rich. My grandfather, Yitzchak, I don't have to tell you how wealthy he was, with Avimelech and all the wells, and Abraham, the whole world knows who he was. We come from a very rich family. Why will a rich kid that has everything he needs steal your cup? That means that he doesn't steal because he doesn't have. He steals for fun because of corrupted traits. You want someone like this in your house? Every second you have to watch him, what is he going to steal the next? You don't want him in your house. This is what Yehuda is telling him, based on the way the Magid Miduvna explained. Binyamin u ben tovim. He has everything he wants in his father's house, and he still touched it. That means it's his nature. You don't want someone that this is his nature in your house. The question is, we have one thing that we don't understand here. Yehuda told him before, if you find the silver cup in our belongings, we all will become your slaves. All of us. That's what he suggested. Now he doesn't even want Binyamin to stay. Didn't you say all of you will be? I told you, no, I'm giving you a discount. I'm only taking one of you, not all of you. You should have been happy. Why are you fighting so much? Before you say, yes, if you find it by us, all of us will be your slaves. Now he doesn't even want to stay. What's changed? In the beginning, you'd have thought that this is it. The prophecy that my grandfather Abraham got from Hashem in Brit Ben HaBetarim begins right now. What did he say to him? That we're all going to be slaves in Mitzrayim. And now he say to us, he comes to us and say, listen, you messed up with the king of Egypt. You stole from here. Oh, you have a very serious problem. So Yehuda say, Shtabach Shemo. The prophecy begins. Now we understand how we're going to get to Mitzrayim. He doesn't let us go. He sends his police after us. So he looked to him that the slavery is about to begin. But when Yosef told him, no, I'm not interested in all of you. You can go back home. Only I want him. So right away he realized, oh, so it's not the decree. I thought, Baruch Hashem, the preparation that Avraham Avinu was informed by Hashem in Brit Ben HaBetarim, we have to be slaves in the hands of the cruel nation, Mitzrayim. Now, it's beginning. Here, we're all going to have to remain here. Our children, our families, we have no way to run. He's holding us here. But when Yosef told him, go, I'm not interested in you. You can go back home. Only he. Then he realized that it's not what he thought. It's not the beginning of the promise of Hashem to Avraham Avinu. And as a result of that, he went very serious to protect him. Because if it's Hashem's will, it's a part of the plan in the world, why should I resist? Hashem knows what he's doing. But if he wants to only keep Binyamin, I have to fight for it. Now Yehuda say, if my father will see that the boy is not there, he will die from a broken heart. The question is like this. Why Judah say to Yosef, if you don't let Binyamin go back home, my father will die. What about the children of Binyamin? He has 10 boys. Binyamin is a father to 10 kids. What's better to say? My old father that is old anyway, it's not so young, he will die soon or later anyway. What's better as a tool in court to use? If you come to the judge, he wants to put someone in jail. What are you going to say to the judge? Oh, he has a father. His father is 130 years old. And it's going to break his heart that his son goes to jail. Oh, you come and say to the judge, dear judge, he has 10 children at home. They're going to lose their father. How something like this will happen? You have to have mercy. Which one is more convincing? Huh? 10 children. If me and you understand that, don't you think Yuda knew it? So if Yuda did not mention anything about his sons, only about his father, what is behind it? Who can tell me what? To bring the boys? He doesn't have to care so much about his boys. The whole point is that that's his brother. The answer is, Rabotai, is like this. The devotion of a father to the son, or the son to the father, which devotion is greater? A son will devote himself fully for his father no matter what? Or a father will devote himself to his son no matter what? Who will have more sacrifice for whom? Father to the son or son to the father? Everyone agree father to the son? מסירותו של האב לבנו גדול יותר מהמסירות של הבן כלפי אביו. Just like you say. Why? Because the devotion and the love of a father to his children, it's in his genes. That's a part of the law of nature. How? Because every one of us inherited from his father. All the way to whom? To Adam. All the way to Adam. Adam HaRishon, he is the one who started to pass this trait to his children. But Adam HaRishon did not have a father. He had children, so he had devotions for his children. But he didn't have a father to be devoted to. Remember, all of us have fathers. But Adam HaRishon never had a father. Hashem made him without parents. No. But biological father that he grew up with, Adam did not have. So he did not know how to be devoted to a father. That's why he could not teach it to his children. Because the children learn from their parents much more from what they do than what they say. You can talk to them non-stop. But if they see you don't keep what you do, what you say, it won't help. But if you do, it affects them a lot. Many times you feel, what's the point? I keep talking and talking and nothing helps. Yes, talking may not help, but the action and the personal example works very much. It's just a matter of time until you see it in their genes. So over here the same. Adam cared very much about his children. That's why his children cared about their children. And that's why everyone cared about, because it's going as a personal example. But Adam never had a father that the children of Adam will see how he respects his father. That's why the devotion of a father to his children is higher than the children to the father. Children, especially in America, as long as they get what they want, they're happy. Even if the father doesn't come home for a month. As long as they get the sneakers and the restaurant and the money, they're good. Actually, some of them are very happy that the father is not home. Why? He cannot be a policeman on them. Huh? You know, like when the kids want to do something. When the mother is home, it's easy to fool her because she's anyway functioning from her heart. She's not the type to give punishments or whatever, or to take things away. But the father is a different story. That's why they begin their investigation the day before, if the father will be here tomorrow evening or not. Abba, you going tomorrow to learn with your chevruta? Tomorrow? Why are you asking? No, I'm just asking. Yeah, tomorrow. Okay. After 2 minutes, you see, he goes with his brother. Yes. What? We're free tomorrow. No policeman in the house. And if you say to him, no, tomorrow the chevruta went away, it's not going to be. You don't have another chevruta there that you can learn with? All of a sudden, he cares about his father, neshama. This is the way the world is, Rabotai. People don't want a policeman on their head. Once they have someone around that tells them what to do, what not to do, how to play, not to play, not to break, not to make noise, they're not so happy. But the devotion of the parents to their children is higher. Now we're going to learn something very, very important. Very important. You know, everything from the parasha you learn for life. Yehuda say, Ech e'ele el avi ve'anar enenu iti. How will I go to my father and the boy is not with me? Literally, what Yosef is talking about, how will I go to my father Yaakov when Binyamin is not with me, as I promised? What's the secret behind this verse? Remember my last week lecture over here? Remember last Monday's lecture or no? What was last Monday's lecture? Who remembers? What was the, at least the first half an hour, what was it? Huh? Speaking about public school, putting children in public school. Remember the attack in Rigo Park? The boy that was attacked? I was talking about the damage of the children that their parents actually killed their soul by putting them in public school. This is it, Rabotai. The explanation behind this is when a person will die, and he comes to Hashem. There's a very big difference if you come in front of Hashem and the boy is with you, your children, or when you come in front of Hashem and the children are not with you. How can your children be with you and how your children cannot be with you? The answer is, are your children shomrei Torah mitzvot like you or not? Ech ele el avi, how will I go to my father? And my children are not with me. We're not on the same page. I'm Shomer Shabbat, they are goyim. I'm married to a Jewish religious woman, they married to goyot. I don't have tattoos on me, they're full of tattoos. I never touched drugs in my life, they are living with drugs. I never curse. Every other word from their mouth is curse. I don't care about American football or baseball and all this shtuyot, and that's all their life is. I don't listen to all this garbage goyish music. That's all they care about. I am not coming to Hashem with the children are with me. Ech ele ve'anar enoy mi. First question Hashem will ask. After he will finish with my trial, let's see what children you left there. First one, gay. Second one, murderer. Third one, mechalel Shabbat. Fourth one, heroin addict. Fifth one, married to Goya. Sixth one, in jail 20 years for trading with stolen merchandise. The girl, professor in a lefty university, liberal. traitor. Everyone is worse than the other. That's called ve'anar enoiti. The boy is not with me. How will I come to my father and the boy is not with me? The Chachamim say this is a hint to what's going to happen to us if we don't teach the Torah and Judaism to our children. Many religious people are very religious, but they left their children alone. And what happened from them? I don't have to tell you. How many Yemenites and Moroccans came to me over the years? My father is this, my grandfather is a big rabbi in Morocco, my grandfather was the Mori in Teman, in Yemen. Yes, your grandfather, but what about you? Going into jail, going out of jail, going into jail, going... The grandfather was a big tzaddik. The grandfather in Morocco was a big tzaddik. What about his granddaughter married to a guy in Paris? The story of the Jewish nation. Same thing Bukharians. Same thing Persians. Persians, conservative, reform, Beverly Hills, driving their Bentley. Ha ha ha, life is great. His grandfather in Iran would die not to be like him. If you bring, you know what, if I wish I could do it for 1 hour, 1 hour, if it was possible, to bring all of our grandparents from Iran, from Bukhara, from Syria, from Yemen, from Morocco, our grandparents, bring them all together to see their grandchildren. And the grandchildren will see how they begin to scream and to cry, oh, Hashem, I wish I would never have to see that that's what came out of me. Maybe this will shock the grandchildren to wake up before it's too late for them. Take some of your grandparents in Uzbekistan, those who came from Azerbaijan, those who came from Kafkaz, those who came from all these places. Go to Bet Gabriel, see how many pictures of them on the wall. I don't know, 100 pictures. I don't need to be a Navi to see everyone over there down to earth, holy, lover of Torah, modesty, religion, simple life, Shomrei Shabbat, humble, great relationship. Hey guys, I look at the people, I look at their faces in a picture. Then I go and I see some of the grandchildren, how they are. Stealing, cheating, lying, business, mafia, drugs, gambling, all day alcohol, tattoos, putting their children in public school even if they're multi-millionaires. What would happen if we bring the grandfather to sit in the same table with his grandson? What do you think would happen? In less than an hour, he will die again from a heart attack. Oily, that I had to see it. Oily. Imagine the holy Moris in Yemen when they see hundreds of the grandchildren are gays in Tel Aviv, Yemenite gays, full of them in entertainment business. Their grandfather in Yemen did not get up from the floor with the Gemara from hundreds of years, sitting and learning. That's what he had in life in Yemen. A donkey, a little bit food, sitting and learning. That's all they did. What did they do? You tell them, this is your grandson, Mori. This is me? This came from me? That's not a Jew, that's a goy. It cannot be mine. Sorry to disappoint you, Mori. You were a rabbi in Yemen. This is what came out of you, courtesy of the Israeli Zionist communist government that hates Hashem so much and Torah. And what would he say? I had a dream to go to the Holy Land. This is what I lived for? This is my dream for? That my grandchildren will become like this? I heard that the Persian rabbi from Brooklyn approximately a week ago, someone told me that he spoke perhaps in one of his lectures and he said that the Persian Jews in Iran are better off staying in Iran, should not come to America. Because look what happened to the Persian people in America. Almost none of them is religious. 5% may be religious. 95% are not Shomer Shabbat. 95%. I'm not talking about the intermarriage and all the other problems. So better they stay in Iran. In Iran, almost everyone is religious. And there's no intermarriage in Iran. You cannot marry Muslim. You can. Even if you were intimate with a Muslim, they force you to convert to Islam or they kill you. And if it was done when you were still a Jew, it's death penalty. One person told me that something like this happened to a Jew. And they said, we have to check at the time of your sin with this Fatma if you were Jewish or Muslim. If at the time of your relationship with her you were a Jew, we're going to kill you now. It was against the law. So they had to go to people to bribe them by fortune of money, Muslims, to give a certificate that this Muslim Jew, which now he lives like a Muslim, actually converted to Islam before he was with Fatma. You understand what's going on here? So in Iran, you cannot marry the Goyim. You cannot be with the Goyim. It's against the rules. If you go to Iranian court, there is no secular court in Iran. There is Muslim court. And you are Jewish. You're not supposed to come here. You have to go to your rabbi. There is Muslim court and Jewish court. There's no secular rules in Iran. There is Muslim court. You're not belong here. You're Jew. Go to where your religion is. Go to the rabbi. Go to the Beit Din. That's what it is. I had a guest this Shabbat in my house. He came from Iran when he was a teenager. You have to see the stories he was telling us about the way they live there with the synagogues and the community. And believe it or not, as much as we hate the Iranian regime and their hate to Israel and their plan to destroy Israel and America, they were pretty fair to the Jewish people when it comes to religion. Told us a lot of surprising stories about religion, about praying, certain things. You Jew, you're allowed. For instance, Muslims are not allowed to have alcohol. They hit you with a whip if they catch alcohol by you. Big embarrassment. Jews have special certificate. If you're Jewish, that you're allowed to have alcohol in your house. It's against the rules, but you're Jewish. According to your religion, you're allowed. And all kinds of different things that Jews are allowed because they are Jewish. They give them certificate that they're allowed to do. In Israel, the Israeli government will do everything they can to destroy the religion. In case you didn't know, they will never ever allow the religious law to pass unless they have no choice, because they need the religious people for the government, otherwise they don't have a government. But if it was up to them, they will wipe out the religion. Everything, Shabbat, Yom Kippur, everything. The Muslim regime that wants to destroy half of the world, they gave more respect to the Jews in Iran than the Israeli government give. That's the truth. I'm not their fan, don't get me wrong. But the truth has to be said. So one rabbi said, they better off stay in Iran. Everybody jumped and screamed. How can he say such thing? Why can't you handle the truth? What's better, that life physically will be better, or the life of the soul will be better? What does the Gemara say? Gadol amachti'o yoter min ha'orgo. You bring the Iranian Jews from Iran to here, they almost all of them become modern after 20 years, and Hashem Yirachem. Same thing happened to them in Israel. Same thing happened to the Moroccans. Same thing happened to the Syrians. Same thing happened to the Bukharian. Baruch Hashem, we have a wave of Baalei Tshuva. We save the new generation as much as we can. But what happened to the parents here in the last 30 years? What happened to them? They were more religious than their parents in Uzbekistan or in Iran or in Syria, or less religious? Your grandmother in Syria will walk with a miniskirt and high heels and red lipstick? Your Iranian grandmother would walk half naked on the street, calling herself religious? I have a friend in Monsey. His mother was Persian. She passed, I don't know, say 7 years ago, something like this. Every time I walk into his house, it was for me shiur musar about modesty. She was in her 80s. Every 10 to 20 seconds, she would make sure no hair comes out of her cover. Every 10 to 20 seconds. Checking, nonstop. Her modesty. In her 80s. I'm sitting with her son talking in a kitchen over there by the table. She sits over there by the living room in the table. Every few seconds she checks, make sure that hair doesn't come out. It's in the genes already, the modesty. That's how it used to be. But today, Hashem Yirachem. So why people got upset at him? Why? They eat, they have what to eat in Iran, yes. They have a place to sleep, yes. They have synagogues, they learn Torah, they celebrate the Jewish holidays, they have Sifrei Torah, they have no intermarriage, they married each other. Don't get me wrong, I'm not saying that everyone over there is ultra-Orthodox. I'm sure there are people who are not religious, but it's definitely much better than the situation of the Jewish communities here in America. And even in Syria, they say that there was, mamash before the war, 150 Jews. One time they show in Israel a little video, 5 minutes, of the Syrian community in Syria. Everyone religious. Their life is in a shul. All day in a shul, in and out, business shul, that's it. What else there was to do over there? But once life become modern with all kinds of options, and the Satan begins to drill in your head, go to college, be a doctor, be a professor, be a lawyer. Yes, be, and then you become a goy. And that's reality. Check how many children don't even want to talk to religious parents. I have a friend, Baal Tshuva. His children from his first marriage do not want to say hi to him because he became religious. Where did you ever hear things like this by the Sfaradim? Where? The brainwash that they went through when they came to this country, the brainwash and the hate to everything that is connects to Hashem and to the Torah, of course they would be better off staying over there. What's the question, Bechlad? So now, the Messer here, how will I go to my father and my children are not with me? This is a goy, this is a gay, this is that. Look at my children, what happened to them? Now Yosef say to the brothers, don't be upset. Ve'ata al te'atzvu. Don't be sad. Ve'al ichar be'enechem. And don't be upset. Ki mechartem oti ena. That you sold me to hear. Ki lemichya shlachani elokim lifnechem. Now we see that it was all Hashem's plan. That Hashem wanted me to come here to prepare the food for you when you will come here. When there was going to be hunger in the world. So Hashem already sent me here for the time that you will need food. What Yosef told them, it's accurate according to the Jewish ideology or no? What do you think? Tell me if what he said is correct or no. Can you say it in a speech? Someone came to kill you. He kidnapped you. He sold you to a mafia, to a Russian mafia, for peanuts, because he hates you. And now you went to Russia and became the new Putin. And now one day you come to Russia and you found out that the brother that you sold to the Russian mafia became the president of Russia. And he said to you, don't worry, it's Hashem did it. You have nothing to worry, don't be upset. It was all Hashem's will. Correct or incorrect?
Correct.
Or partially correct? If we say it's correct, then no one is guilty. Also the Nazis are not guilty. It's problematic. What do you want from the Nazis? It was Hashem's plan. They only did mitzvah, what Hashem told them to do. They're robots. What do you want from them? Why they have to be punished? Why we hate them so much? Why we say machshimam? What do you want from them? If that was Hashem's will, and he needed to use someone to do the job, you have to have a pity on them, no? According to what you say. Then it removes any responsibility from human being. Everything that someone does to someone, you can always come and say, oh, that's what Hashem wanted. I had no say here. I'm so sorry that Hashem used me to kill people, but it has to get done. So what Yosef told them, it's correct or no? Or you just want to make them feel good? Are they guilty or not guilty? Because based on what he say here, don't be sad. And don't be upset that you sold me over here. Because kilem ichya shlachani elokim lifnechem. Hashem wanted me to arrive here to prepare what you need for the time to come. It's true or not true? Well, if God does everything, why we judge people? Why we judge murderers? Why we judge abusers? Why? We have it's a catch-22. On one hand, we know 100% that every maneuver in the world, everything that happens, revolution, kings go up, king goes down, wars, death, earthquakes, tsunamis, anything you can think of, it's all needs the approvals of Hashem. If Hashem did not want, nothing could have happened. If Hashem wants the Jews to lose their property and run away to a different country, it will happen one way or the other. If Hashem wants someone to die, he will die no matter what. If Hashem wants someone to be sick, he will be sick no matter what. So why we judge the people who did Hashem's will?
They have freedom of choice to choose.
Very good. Because they had freedom of choice. They chose to do it. But we run into a big problem now. They chose exactly what Hashem wanted them to choose. It's a little bit fishy. Did they have a chance to choose something that Hashem didn't want? If Hashem wanted the Jews get killed, the Goy could have chose otherwise or no? Today in Arab, Imach Shimo shot few Israelis. One of them was a pregnant woman. Shot her, and the baby is in critical condition. She was 7 months pregnant, and the doctors somehow took the baby out in cesarean when the mother is in very hard condition, and the baby is also in hard condition. And now someone say, on the way here, I heard that the Arabs say she's pregnant, shoot at her first. I told you, the Arabs and the Nazis, no difference in a cruelty when it comes to that. When you have a cruel Arab, Hashem Yerachem, the sky is not even the limit. How much they hate us. Instead of saying, leave her alone, she's pregnant, shoot at her first, she's pregnant. Like this, you kill 2 Jews in 1 shot. I don't care. They have no mercy, no feelings, no nothing. That's why you see it has nothing to do with soldiers, not soldiers. They come and shoot at women. Nothing to do with soldiers, occupations, baloney. It's pure hatred to Jews. And who made it? Hashem. Hashem sent them to torture us. What's the question? It's written clearly in Parashat Bechukotai. It's written clearly in Parashat Bechukotai. Every country that have problems with modesty, Hashem send them cancer. Who is the cancer? The Muslims. Check. Spain started to open up art, music, theaters, stadiums. Muslim can occupy Spain. Morocco, same thing. Iran, same thing. Shah, Iran was like France, the fourth country in the world. Modern, advanced, beautiful clothes, lots of money, beautiful architect. Unbelievable Iran was. Beautiful mansions, all. Whew, life over there was better than Europe. Wealthy country, all on a lot, oil, Iranian Shah, Jews, professor, doctors, everyone is a king over there. Over, all Muslim came over to the place, Islam went back 1,000 years in time. Mamash, it's like taking them 1,000 years back. Israel, Jews started to rebel against Hashem, all of a sudden the Arab gained power. The Arab were in Israel for 2,000 years, they could not grow one tomato. One tomato they could not grow. It was all swamps. Couldn't grow anything. For 2,000 years since the destruction of the temple, there were Arabs living there. Jews came back, dried all the swamps, made Israel paradise, beautiful country. All of a sudden, out of nowhere, the Arabs taking over every place. You cannot move. You're living as a hostage in your own home. That's really reality. Where does it say it in the Torah? Maybe I'm making up things. It's written in Parashat Bechukotai. Agoy asher bekirbecha ya'ale mala mala, v'ata tered mata mata. The nation that lives among you will rise higher and higher, while you go lower and lower. And I will send after you a sword of revenge. What kind of revenge? Nekam brit. Revenge because of sins of brit milah. Every time there is lack of modesty, sins that connects to brit milah, the Arab shows up. Check the history. So what do you want from them? They only do what Hashem wants. If it wouldn't be Mustafa, it would be someone else. Hashem is doing it to us. If you don't get it, don't call yourself a believer Jew. You believe in the 13th principle of Judaism? If yes, then you know everything that happens to us, we brought on ourselves. I know it doesn't sound politically correct. I know it disturbs a lot of people. But before you get angry and begin to bark, just stop 1 second and think. Is this the truth or not? Forget what you want, forget what's comfortable, forget what you like. Leave it aside. Reality. Is this one of the 13 principles of Judaism? If it happened to you, you deserve it? Yes. Hashem rewards the righteous, punish the wicked? Yes. Everything that happens needs the approval of Hashem? Yes. All the enemies who chase us and kill us and throw us out of the land? It's 100% from Hashem. It's written in Parashat Bechukotai. The nation among you will rise and torture you. Nekam brit. Ve'ne'saftem el arechem. Your country becomes smaller and smaller. Why? Because you rebel against me. It's clearly. Clearly over there. So, Yosef said to them, Hashem wanted me to get here. Don't feel upset. Did Yosef say to them, it's not your fault? No. Yosef just told them, don't be sad and don't be upset. What they should answer him? You're not comforting us at all. Why? We chose to do what we did to you. Whatever Hashem wanted, that's regardless. We chose to do it. מדבריו של יוסף משמע that they didn't have בחירה, like they did not choose. But the truth is that they had בחירה. They chose it and they did get punished for that. What was their punishment? They came back in Gilgul, in reincarnation. The 10 הרוגי המלכות, the 10 martyrs, that the Roman slaughter, Rabbi Shvav, Rabbi Ishmael, Rabban Gamliel, all the Chachamim, Rabbi Akiva, We sit on Tisha B'Av and on the floor and cry for this Asara chief, 10 chief rabbis that were killed in the worst, cruel way by the Romans. Who are they? The brothers of Yosef. They are the ones. So if Hashem wanted it, and it was a part of the plan, why even taking one hair off their head? Why they had to be killed in such a horrible way? Everything in life is midah keneged midah. And that's very scary for those of you who have brain in their head. Why it's very scary? Because they stood in front of Yosef, and Yosef technically, maybe not 100%, but technically forgave them and gave them gifts and invited them to be his guest in Egypt and sponsored them for years and gave them food and money for free. And it was not enough to dismiss them from a horrible execution. Nobody can escape the judgment. No one. That's reality. It's crazy. Mamash panic. Not only that, Rav Aaron Mikerlin, big tzaddik, used to say something very interesting. But before I'm going to say, I want to ask you a question. Is there any mitzvah in the Torah to be happy? Mitzvah to be happy. There is such mitzvah in the Torah or no?
Yes.
One say no, you say yes, I heard you. There is any mitzvah in the Torah not to be said? Sin. There is any restriction in the Torah not to be said? Does it say anywhere in the Torah you're not allowed to be said? Does it say anywhere in the Torah to be happy? We say all the time, mitzvah liot besimcha. Where does it say such thing? There's only one time the Torah commands you to be in simcha. When? In holidays. V'samachta b'chagecha v'ha'ita ach sameach. What about the rest of the year? Of course, it's good to be happy. There's no obligation. If there was an obligation to be happy every day of your life, why you need to tell me to be happy in a holiday? If any, in a holiday, people are normally happy because they don't have to go to work, and they don't have to deal with their customers, and they don't have to deal with headache and traffic, and they sit with their family and eat ashpolo. So of course they'll be happy. Good l'chaim, good wine, good whiskey, family getting dressed, everyone together, that's usually time that people are happy. You don't need to tell them to be happy. You have to tell them to be happy when they are at work or when they are in the middle of a war. That's when you need to tell people to be happy, because by them they're normally sad. But in a holiday, when can you be happy if not then? And the Torah says, "V'samachta b'chagecha v'ayita ach sameach." Mashma, the rest of the year, there's no clear obligation. Rav Aaron Mikerlin says something beautiful, brilliant. This is what it says. Asimcha kshelatzma ena mitzvah. Happiness by itself is not an obligation. But happiness can bring a person to keep all the mitzvot of the Torah. It's not a mitzvah by itself, but if you make sure to be happy, it's a guarantee to make you a wonderful religious person that keep all the mitzvot. Because when you're happy, you do everything right. On the other hand, sadness, it's not a sin. There's nowhere in the Torah it says not to be sad. But sadness can bring a person to commit all the sins of the Torah. This is how the Satan works. The Satan, obviously, all the time brings us temptations. Different kind of temptations. Once we fail, and we actually commit the sin, what is the next thing the Satan does right away?
Make you feel bad.
Very good. Both of you say the answer. Immediately the Satan comes now and take advantage on your heart burning and your bad feeling and your conscious guilt. And the Satan comes to you and say to you, look at you, you loser. How many times you heard the CDs of the rabbi about Shabbat? How many times? And again you fell. No. You want to call yourself a religious person? How many times you heard to watch your eyes and not to do not modest things? And again you fail, and again. How many times you heard not to be a pig? You're not an animal. Control your appetite. Control how much you eat. And again you fail. How many times you heard how important it is to learn Torah and not to be a clown? And again you don't learn. So right away the Satan, after he made you fail in the test, he comes now to bury you all the way by making you sad. You sad not because you lost money. That's a different part of sadness. You are sad right now that you actually fail. Your partner drove you crazy and you attacked him verbally, and a minute later when you relaxed, you feel horrible about what you did. And now the Satan is putting you down and depressed, and for 3 days you don't come to work and you don't wake up for Shachrit. One thing leads to another. This is the biggest danger, and it happens to a lot of religious people. They see that things don't work the way it should because they are weak. They don't have strength. And they give up on everything. Rabbi, what's the point? Anyway, I'm not waking up. Anyway, I'm not doing this. I'm not doing that. So now from here on to go mamash to become a goy, it's a matter of a month. You stop coming to shul. Next thing, you're not going on Shabbat to shul. Next thing, you don't get up for kiddush. Quickly. Tak, 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 like a building collapse one floor after the other. A year later, he's walking already in the street with Christine. Moshe, what's this? What happened? A year ago, we were together in yeshiva, davening nets in a shul. What happened to you? Don't ask. Now he begins with the excuses. What is he going to say? He made sins and he broke? Yeah, I heard this and I heard that. It's not so simple. I'm tired. Actually, I've never been religious. It was all a show. The Satan is a great lawyer. You know? As a great lawyer. You know, one time they made a joke that the wall between heaven and hell fell down. There was an earthquake between heaven and hell. And the people of hell and the people of heaven had a big argument in a court of heaven who should rebuild the wall. And the people of hell won. And the question is why? Who knows why? Why the people of hell won? It's all lawyers. Very good. It's full of lawyers over there. A lot of liberal lawyers. A lot of religious people who went to be lawyer in secular court. Suing people, defending criminals, becoming judges. And then what do? They know in their subconscious that they are doing something that is against the Torah. What do you think? If a person is a criminal lawyer or a judge in a court with a yarmulke, in Israel, in Manhattan, doesn't matter. He knows that the Torah speaks about someone like this that he cannot even be a part of a minyan. And he has no share to the world to come. It's a total apicorous criminal. So what do you think he's going to do? To let go of his honor and his achievement, after all, he went to a college and to become a lawyer, to law school, it took about 10 years of his life and cost him $200,000-$300,000 of expenses. Now when he finally became a famous big shot and he stands in a court and everyone bow down to him or people call him your honor, to give up all this because it's against the Torah. Come on, Rabbi, you're asking too much. So what people like this will do to feel good? Who knows? What will they do? Two things. One, either they donate a lot of money to Jewish causes. And second, they open charity organization. They open organizations to help what we call Gmach, Gmilut Chasadim. Why they would do it? To ease the pain of their subconscious, knowing that they live in a lie every minute of their life. But I can't let go the honor and how many people bow down to them. You know what it is to sit on a stage and people ask you, your honor, may I come forward? You feel like God. You know what it is, your honor? You're wearing this thing, everyone's shaking, you walk in, people stand up. One rabbi said that for years, when they invited him to a wedding of one of his students in Israel, he's poor, he's making a small salary. He said, my weekly salary was the price of the cab back and forth. My weekly salary from yeshiva. Ask me, why will a rabbi that works so hard all day teaching Gemara, breaking his head, making a lousy salary, why will he spend everything he earned this week to go to someone's chuppah? For the 1 minute pride that they give him the glass of wine and say, Ya'amod kvod harav ha-gadol, Rosh Yeshiva ha-melamed ha-gadol. What? Sheva brachot. They give him a bracha. Bracha harita mechubad harav ta-ta-ta-ta-ta. For the 2-3 minutes of fame, I would burn my weekly salary just for that 3 minutes of honor. At least he was honest to confess. It's not like that anymore. It's much easier to talk about your past sins than current sins. After he overcome this desire of honor and pride and kavod, Ben Zion Abba Shaul said, we can learn a lot from the stupid people that wants to sit in the mizrach of the shul, in the important chairs. If somebody come and sit in their chair, how angry they get. Usually the way it goes, some of the rich people, not all, they come very late to shul. To show their face, to look around, and everyone check their hands. Thank you for what you're doing for the community. It's called in Israel, Igzor Kupon. You know, the coupon. You know how the politicians show up when they finish the building to cut the string? That's more or less the same idea. He doesn't come really to daven or to stay for the rabbi's speech. He comes just to check that everyone bowed down to him because he helped to build a new section in the shul.
To remind them,
I'm around. Listen, I'm still here. So usually they give them respect. They sit in a mizrach, sometimes on a stage. The rabbi sits here. And the head of the board is sitting over here, or the first row. So Rabbi Zion Abba Shaul say, how many times you saw that the shul is packed, and only the front row is still empty because the rich people did not wake up yet? And then when they finally come to shul at 9:30, as a guest that is not from the community, is only there for Shabbat, he was looking for a place to sit, and he saw every chair is taken, and they're already in Musaf almost. So he came to the first row and sat down until the Gvir showed up. And every Shabbat is the same scenario. He attacks him, shame on you. Why are you sitting? Why you don't ask? It's my seat. How much they willing to embarrass themselves to grab the honor and not let go of the ego. Even though everyone laughs at them. Everyone laughs. Look at him, how he fights for the chair. Well, why do you care so much to sit over there? Sit over there, why do you care so much? No, he has to be in a special place. Why? Ego. So remember, sadness, there's nowhere it says that you're not allowed to be sad. You'll be sad, you'll do all the sins of the Torah. Happiness, it's the greatest recommendation to be happy. Liot besimcha, but is no clear taryag mitzvot, you must adam to be happy every day. But if you won't be happy, you're going to pay the price. So it's a mandatory thing. It's a logical thing. You want to be a good tzaddik, you must be happy. If you be in depression, you cannot be a tzaddik. Depressed people cannot be tzaddikim. They cannot get up in the morning. How do you know if a person loves his life or not? By the way he wakes up in the morning. If his life is full of pleasure and enjoyment, he doesn't want to burn his life by sleeping. Chaval. Every hour will not return. I'll give you an example. Let's say right now you just became a very famous person. You love ego and honor, and you love people to kiss your hand and to bow down to you and to tap on your shoulder. And you just, they put you on television and you won a competition and you became the most famous singer now in Israel. So now, one day after the show, you walk in the street, hundreds of people take pictures with you, hug you, kiss you, we love you, you change our life. Would you go to sleep? Or you would stay up for 3 days in a row? Your wife will tell you, Moshe, why you don't go to sleep? You're up from yesterday's morning. I don't want to waste the moment. These moments will never return. But I'm going to be like a fool in bed, snoring, when I lose all this fame and kavod. Who's going to take a picture of me when I'm snoring in bed?
Wife.
Poor wife. So, וישבת בארץ גושן, אתה ובניך ובני בניך. Yosef said to them, listen, come be my guest. Come to America. I'm the treasury. I'm the right-hand man of Mr. Trump. My family, I know you're suffering very much. Come from Iran into New York. Come. I'll give you everything. I know the Iranian money worth nothing. You cannot buy even one little piece of this chandelier they can buy. They lost all the value of their money over there with the sanctions and everything. But don't worry. I will give you homes. I will give you government credit card, food stamp, Section 8, whatever you want on the house. I'm signing. I'm the government. I am the government. But in one condition. What's the condition? Don't dare to move, not to Queens, not to Manhattan, not to Bronx, not to Staten Island, not to Long Island. So where? Where are we going to be in New York? You know, in upstate New York, over there, I'm going to give you a section. We knock down the trees. You're going to be isolated. And I don't want you to have any connection to the New Yorkers. Why? Why can't I live in Manhattan? You're the government. You can give me an apartment in Manhattan. It's no problem for you. Paro say, call your family. Paro, by the way, when he found out that Yosef is from the royal family of Avraham, Yitzhak, and Yaakov, was he upset or happy? Happy. Why? When he gave Yosef the job, they wrote against him in the New York Times. They say, what kind of a stupid king? He gives jobs to a slave, to an Hebrew slave from jail? Imagine Trump will take now a prisoner from the prison, came out of jail from Sudan, I don't know, it's a place of slaves, Africa, just came out of the jail, young, 30 years old, and said, come, I want you to be my right-hand man to run United States. Now, when he does everything right, they slaughter him. Imagine if he does something like this. So right away, all the liberals, the lefties, they write in the newspaper, Paro lost his mind. Our king is drunk. What's going on with him? He just got a slave from jail and made him the most powerful person? He was getting a lot of criticism. It's no joke. I make it sound like a joke, but that's exactly what happened. So they all came to him and said, what did you see in this slave to make him the most powerful person in the world? He said, I see some royalty in him. But obviously, the people still criticize him. Now when he just came out, the brothers of Yosef are here. Yosef is not a slave. Yosef is the grandson of the legendary Avraham, Yitzhak, and Yaakov. Everyone in the world knew them. What does it say in the Torah when Avraham Avinu came? They say, you are the president of Hashem in us, among us. What Ephron told him. Take everything for free. You're the most important person in the world. The Plishtim, what did they say to Yitzchak? You're the most powerful person in the world. Come back with us. Let's make peace. We don't want to mess with you. This is the most famous family in the world. They just found out that these Hebrew slaves that everyone made fun at him is actually coming from a family that is a lot better than us. Just like Trump. When he married his daughter to this Jew, a lot of people thought, oh, this Jew wanted the daughter of Trump because she's probably very rich. I thought like this. Until one person told me, no, you fool. He's 3 times more wealthy than Trump. This family is much wealthier than Trump. His grandparents, Holocaust survivor, who came to America with nothing and established here a big empire of real estate, much more established than him. They are a bank. They give loans, every loan, 30 million, 50 million. It's a very big family. Ah, so that changed the whole thing. I didn't marry her because she was a daughter of a rich man. I'm much wealthier than them. I don't need them for the money. So, Yosef say, I want you to be in an isolated place. The Chachamim say, why Yosef wants his family to be in the land of Goshen? Goshen. There's no sewer over there. No nothing. It's an isolated place. Why did not put his father in a palace? Give his father next door a house. You in Washington by the White House. There's a lot of nice buildings over there. You want your family to come while you're the treasury of the United States. Give them in Washington next to you a beautiful mansion or a building for the whole family. Don't forget, there was no train, no cars, no helicopters. Every time Yosef wants to go to visit in family in Goshen, it's very, very far. It will take days to take a carriage and go overnight in the middle of the desert. Who wants this headache? There's no telephone, no Skype. You cannot talk on WhatsApp video. It was a little bit different, the world. Every time Yosef wants to visit them, a week is gone. I'm the most busy person in the world. Do I have time to waste a week every time I want to see my father or my brother? I tell them, go live in upstate New York, all the way in the mountain, with no phone, no internet, no nothing. Why? You did not see your father for so many years. So many years you did not see your father. Finally now your father is back with you. He's 130 years old and he's very old. He looks very old. When Paro saw him, he got shocked. He said, why you look so bad? Why you look so old? My life was horrible, Yaakov said. Bad life make a person look older. Everybody knows it. The answer is, Rabotai, with all the physical difficulty, with all the pain of not being close to your father that you love so much, there is one thing that is the most important thing. What would be the exposure to my family from this goyim? Can I put my family in a neighborhood with all these goyim here? What's going to be the future of my family? In 2-3 generations, they will get assimilated with this Egyptian and that will be the end of us. I rather suffer all the suffering in the world that my family will not be mixed with this goyim, Manhattan, here, this and that. And what happened? Later, you will see in the next parashot, the Torah said that they all moved out of Eretz Goshen and filled up the entire land of Egypt. They didn't like the ghetto, the isolation. So what happened? It's written, Mal'a ha'aretz otam. They moved everywhere. Or they occupied Forest Hills. They built all the mansions. They occupied Great Neck. They occupied Westbury. They occupied Manhattan. They occupied upstate. They occupied everywhere, Brooklyn. The goyim went crazy. Look what's going on. These Jews taking over the world. They're in Wall Street. They're in the hospitals. the chief, the FBI, what is it? Everywhere Jews. How many Jews are in the world? If you live in New York, every other person in power is a Jew. If you don't know the geographic map of the world, how many Jews you would assume there are in the world? Do you know in Russia, they ask the primitive Russians, not the educated one. They made a survey. They asked them which country is the most powerful besides the United States and Russia. They answered Israel. They asked them, do you know how big Israel is? How many Jews there are? They thought it's just as big as them. They told them, no, it's smaller than Moscow. The Russian went crazy. Huh? Every, what we hear, Israel, 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 every minute, Israel, Jews, this, how can it be? Nobel Prize winners, half of them Jews. What's going on here? Half of the doctor, Jews. Half of the judges, Jews. Half of the lawyer, Jews. What's going on here? Small group. Occupy the world. Spiritually, physically, wealth. But there was a very heavy price for it. The price is that we should have been 3 billion Jews today, and we are less than 15 million Jews. 99.8% of the Jewish people got murdered spiritually by themselves. Do you understand what I'm saying or no? Assimilated with a goyim and they are gone. That's it. After 2-3 generations, nobody even knows that your grandfather used to be Jewish or grandmother. So it's over. Nobody knows. That's it. You yourself don't even know that your grandmother was Jewish. There's no way to know. You are gone from the world. In reality, you only have just under 2 million Jews that have connection to Hashem in the whole world. From 7.5 billion people, only 2 million max that have some kind of connection with Hashem. If you begin to screen the level of religion of these 2 million people, you will be left in best case scenario with 50,000 people. That's it. This is from my 24 years of experience dealing with the public. I did a rough estimate. 50,000 people that have real connection to Hashem. Love to Hashem, modesty, devotion, emunah, faithful in the mitzvot, zealous to Hashem, not liberal, not have rotten ideology like all the university rabbis here and all the fake frum people that are nothing but frum. They're not frum at all. And all these people who went after the money and the education and the universities and forgot Hashem a long, long time ago. If you screen all the fakers, maybe 50,000 you have from 7.5 billion people. And if you are wondering how can it be, don't be surprised. The Gemara already say, heaven is very small and hell is huge, huge. Heaven is very, very small. Only very few people make it there. Very few. Because as I explained many, many times to those who wants to listen, it's not enough just to put a kippah and tzitzit and grow a little beard. No. That doesn't make you religious. The real way to check if a person is religion, there's a 10 commandments of the religious person. You know what they are? How much you love Hashem. What's the comparison between the love to Hashem compared to the love to yourself? Where is the love of Hashem and where is the love to yourself? If the love to Hashem is very high, it makes the love to yourself go very low. If the love to yourself is very high, the love for Hashem is going very low. And I tell you why. Because loving yourself, loving pleasure, loving success, loving fame, loving glory, loving convenience, it's all the opposite of what the Torah requires. The Torah wants humility, not honor, not pride. Loving yourself makes you proud, and you want fame, you want glory. It's against the Torah. You must reach wealth no matter how. It's against the Torah. You want to lay in bed all day and do nothing. It's against the Torah. You want to have pleasure from a lot of forbidden things. It's against the Torah. You have to give up for the sake of heaven, even though you will pay the price. It's against the Torah. It's very easy to be a speaker that tells the people what they love to hear and tell them some nice stories and jokes. Then 500 people come minimum every lecture, and everyone stands online to kiss your hands and to give you nice checks. They stand online to give you checks, and everyone praises you, and you become the guru of the world. And every lecture you want, you charge $3,000 to come, or five. I heard some even charge more. For one local lecture, to come to speak for 45 minutes, $3,600. Why? Because people love to hear it. Because they only tell you things that you like to hear. Nothing to do with truth. They will never tell you that you have no share to the world to come because you mechalel Shabbat. Never. They never tell you if you're gay, you're going to have a very, very horrible end in the end. If you don't treat your problem. They don't tell you what's the damage of eating not kosher. They don't tell you about the sins, Pgam HaBrit. They don't speak about this thing. Never. Only positive. Positive. They think like you in Hollywood. You want happy end. That everyone smile and happy. Which movies are more successful? Movies with happy end? Or movies that end in a huge tragedy that all the people you like in a movie died? Would you recommend to your friends to go watch the movie with a horrible, disappointing end? No. But if the hero in the end will get saved and run with his lover and escape all the evil people with all the money, you must see this movie. But you have to have patience. Such a surprising end it has. Because people are foolish. Because people are foolish. So, to be religious starts with the ideology. Do you remember the rule that I said a month ago in my lecture in Brooklyn? What's rule number one to know if you're on the right track in Avodat Hashem? Rule number one. Don't forget it. That's the first commandment. Everything Hashem hates, I must hate. Everything Hashem loves, I must love. If what I love is contradicting what Hashem loves, I have a massive spiritual cancer in me. I must clean it out before it's too late. Because cancer kills, spiritual cancer. Everything Hashem hates, I must hate. If there are things that Hashem hates and I love, I am sick. I have spiritual cancer who can grow by the minute. And then there is too late for eternity. Because if I die with that cancer, I'm going to find myself losing everything I work so hard for. Just one simple example. If you are a religious person, when you see a gay parade, it should burn your heart and steam comes out of your ear and you faint from disappointment and sadness and anger, or you should feel joy and happiness and you go take pictures with them and put pictures in your Facebook page and say how much I love the community, I came to support you. A lover of Hashem, a real religious Jew, which one of the two is correct? Test yourself. Do you know how many people from the university who call themselves rabbi admire the Sodom and Gomorrah people? Not only not condemning them, not only doesn't bother them that we have among us tens of thousands of sick people. No. They don't even think something is wrong. They run with such desire to take pictures with them and put them in their Facebook page when the headline is Rabbi such and such. This is the time we live in. And these people think they're religious. Who are they fooling? They're not normal. I'm surprised that the public is so dumb. It's one thing, this guy is chole nefesh. Okay, but how come the public is so stupid? How can it be? It's very convenient for them. Why would I want a strict rabbi who constantly tell me that every minute of my life is a lie? I don't want a doctor like this. I want a doctor who gives me one Advil a day, and that's it. Yalla, go home, enjoy, smoke your cigar, drink, enjoy, eat steaks, no problem. Don't worry about cholesterol, don't worry about health, don't worry about... Just take this pill, everything is fine. But the other doctor, you crazy? MRI, surgery, fast, 1 week, this, that, what? Enough, so much pressure. This pressure will save your life, you fool. You want to smile now for a year and then be dead forever? Or you want someone to cut the cancer out of your system, even though it's painful? Which one of the two a smart person wants? So right away, Jewish ideology means everything Hashem hates, I hate. I see a mixed wedding. Doesn't matter, Persian, Syrian, Bukharian, Ashkenazi, American, doesn't really matter. Jews are Jews. Dancing, women, these high heels, mini skirt, perfume, red lipstick, like in a zoo. I can't even stand there 1 minute. But it's my cousins. So what? I love Hashem more than my cousins. But it's my parents. With all due respect to them, I love Hashem more than them. It upsets Hashem. But it makes my parents happy. Who's more important? This is a decision that every beginner in Judaism has to accept right away. Who comes first? My children or God? My wife or God? My husband or God? My parents or God? My cousins or God? The money or God? My health or God? My life or God? The answer is always God. And if it's not, you are sick with a spiritual cancer. Check yourself. Don't say I did not warn you. That's why I told you 50,000 if we're lucky. Trust me when I know what I'm talking about. Trust me. I go to some event, to Shabbatonim, I see how the religious people behave. I see how the women dress. I see how the children curse. I see how the men behave when they see alcohol. I see everything. I see their addiction to sport. I see the culture of the Greeks. My last lecture, who really won, the Greeks or us? My lecture in Manhattan. And that's the truth. And I want to tell you the solution. What's the medicine? How do I get rid of that cancer? There's only one way. Constant Torah learning. Constant learning to lectures. Constant. 3, 4, 6, 10 hours a day listen to lectures. Why did I make so many CDs for? Why? That it'll be on a shelf or thrown somewhere in your car and you never even look at it? Forget about radio, forget about music, forget about news, forget about this. None of it will bring you anywhere. Most of it is full of sins and lashon hara and waste of time. All that time, strong Torah and Ashkafa and Musar and connection to Hashem. Life is a blink of the eye. Between the family and your job and your work and davening and all that, how much time you have left for your soul? Not that much. And if that time you have for your soul, you're going to waste on sport and of the rest of the nonsense that you watch all day, what chance you have to succeed? What chance you have to succeed? So, even though it's so difficult to commute, doesn't matter. We didn't come here for a picnic. I see you once a month. I see you once a year, dead. I don't want you and your grandchildren to become assimilated over here. This is Egypt. Glory. Beautiful real estate, lots of wealth, everyone is rich, all the wealth of the world came here. You want to live among them in Manhattan in all these fancy buildings? What's going to come out of you? 80% intermarriage in the United States, that's the last statistic. 80%. Similar to what was before the Holocaust started. In Germany, they reached 80% assimilation. 80%. What does Hashem need us here, Bichlal? We all betrayed him. Almost all of us are traitors. Even those who are religious, do you know how many of them are lefty? How can it be that a person with a yarmulke on his head will vote Democrats? How can it be? How can it be? What Democrats are? Pro-gay, pro-gay marriage, pro-abortion, pro-stealing money from the rich and giving it to the poor who do nothing with their life. That's Democrats. Hater of religion, hater of everything that Hashem hates, they love. And everything Hashem loves, they hate. That's Democrats. Not that the Republicans are much better. They also have a lot of problems. But at least there is something good about them. Something. What's a Democrat? Pro-Iran, pro-Palestinian. Most of them anti-Semite hate Jews. What are they? They're enemies of Hashem. They're pro-abortion, taking innocent baby and murdering them, and it doesn't bother them. They're pro-gay marriage. If Democrats will take all over, everything, everything, every state in America will marry men to men, people with animals. That's the price of liberalism. And what do you think would be the retaliation of Hashem? Read Sodom and Gomorrah, what happened to them. We're very close to it anyway. We think, we can do whatever we want. There is something that called in the Torah, Igdish et ha-se'ah. You heard this or no? Did you hear this expression or no? Do you know what it means, Igdish et ha-se'ah? I'll tell you what it means. Every person has in heaven a tank. Every name come to the world, he has a tank. How big is your tank is depend on who you used to be in your previous life. What's your potential? What kind of soul you have? How bright your brain is? What family you are born to? It depends on many, many things. Hashem sent you back to the world in reincarnation. And he puts you in a specific test. In Queens, in Brooklyn, in Tel Aviv, no matter where you are. Every person has a tank. This tank is the tank of the sins. How many sins this tank can fill? So when a person gets to age bar mitzvah or bat mitzvah, the sins begin to accumulate. Break Shabbat, something went in. May add forbidden intimacy, another one. Lashon hara goes in. Eat not kosher goes in. Rambam says sometimes one sin is equal like a thousand, and some mitzvot equal like a thousand mitzvot. So if you have chilul Shabbat, that's like a thousand other sins. Because that's karet for the soul. It's that penalty. It's not a joke. So now what happened? This, the tank, goes up and down. The level of the sin on the tank is from 0 to 100%. It goes up, but it can also go down. How it goes up, we just understood. How does it go down? Tshuva, Yom Kippur, giving tzedakah, praying, asking for forgiveness, working on your character, doing good things to people, supporting yeshiva, making other Jews become religious so they work for you. So it constantly goes up and down. So for instance, if you really do tshuva in Elul, it can go down 30%. You erase a lot of your sins. You give a big amount of charity, it goes down a lot. Zakat atzil mimavet. That's what it means. That once you are close to 100%, once you get to 100%, there's no room to spill out. That's called in Judaism, Igdish et ha-se'ah. Se'ah is the top, Igdish means gadush. Above the max. That's it, there's no room. It explodes. What is this explosion? It's death. Person must die. He cannot stay another second in the world. That's why we said tzedakah tatzil mimavet, because if you're 99% already, another sin or two can get you up to 100. So you gave a very big check, or you did a service to someone, or you saved someone from who knows what. So immediately it goes down. It goes up, it goes down, it goes up, it goes down. When you duplicate yourself by making a lot of other Jews become religious, you give them books, you give them CDs, you give them USBs, you invite them to lectures, you broadcast lectures in your press share in your Facebook. When you watch live, you press share, it goes to 300 people. So the more people become interested in Hashem, and in Torah, and in Shabbat, now you actually duplicated yourself to 300 people. Because it's not you anymore. There are 300 people who are Shomer Shabbat thanks to you or thanks to your money. So that's why they keep your tank very, very low. Because it's not only you. You may do bad things, but all your soldiers out there are doing a lot of great things, which constantly bring your level down. That's why the Gemara say, Mezaket Arabim en chet ba'al yado. Ve'en ha'arod memit, ela ha'chet memit. The Gemara say, Rabbi Hanina ben Dosa, there was a snake in the ground. Everyone was nervous, because once he beat you, that's it, you're dead. Rabbi Hanina ben Dosa asked them, where is the snake? They told him, right there. He put his ankle right there, took off his shoe, put his ankle in a hole. The snake came out and beat him. So Rabbi ran to the water. This was Arod. Whoever gets it to the water first, make it, and the other one will die. Something very, very special. He doesn't run. Rabbi, run! There's nothing to run. Why? The snake does not kill. The sins kill. He knew he doesn't make any sins. I never make sins. Never. He knew his level of Yirat Shamayim. The world will explode and I still won't make a sin. That's it. So why should I run? We are not in this level, obviously. We have to go to doctors and medicine and shots and surgeries. Why? Because we have tons of sins. That's why we need an army, and that's why we need medicine, and that's why we need so many other things. Because we are full of sins. But a person that has no sins, nothing can touch him. The Gemara says four people never made a sin. They only died because Hashem cursed the human race to die. Adam and Chava. Because of the sin of Adam and Chava. Adam and Eve. Without that, they will never die. Who? Ishai, the father of David. Kilav, the son of David. Binyamin, the son of Yaakov. And Amram, the father of Moshe Rabbeinu. Four people that never made a sin. They should have never died, the Gemara say. Why? Because the sin kills. But they have to die. Why? Because Hashem decreed on human race that they live X amount of years and they must move out of here. Without that decree, they will never die. Why? Because cancer doesn't kill. Heart attack doesn't kill. Epidemic doesn't kill. Of course they kill, because Hashem sends them. But they kill the one Hashem wants to die. Many people got cancer. Not everyone died. Some people make it. Some people never get it. Many people go to the war. Bombs fall everywhere. One will die, three other didn't. Arabs get on a bus and shoot. Many people were there. Every bullet has an address. Nothing is coincidence. Nothing. And let's finish with this. Vayipol al tzavare binyamin achi vayevk. Rashi say, Vayipol al tzavare binyamin. Tzavare, it's plural. Tzavar, it's neck. You don't say great necks. Great neck. One neck. It's not proper. Great necks. My necks. My necks hurt. What? Vayipol al tzavare binyamin achi vayevk. He fell on the neck of his brother and cried. They both cry. He cried for the two temples that will be in a tribe of Binyamin's property in Israel, and both of them will be destroyed. And Binyamin cries on the temporary temple, the Mishkan Shiloh, that was in a share of Yosef, and was also destroyed, eventually will be destroyed. Now it's buried. Shlomo HaMerech buried under Bet HaMikdash. But eventually he will be destroyed once the third temple will be built. We don't need it anymore. The question is like this. Yosef is crying for the temples that were destroyed in a property of Binyamin. Why both temples were built in Binyamin? Why? Why both temples were built by Binyamin? Binyamin did not bow down to Esav. Everyone else bowed down to Esav. Binyamin did not bow down to Esav. Both temples were in his property. Binyamin cried on Mishkan Shiloh, that is in the property of Yosef. It should have been that Yosef will cry for the destruction of Shiloh,
in his property, and Binyamin should cry for what broke in his property. Who are you crying for? For the house of your neighbor who fell down in a hurricane? Or to your house that fell? Why you cry on his house and he cry on your house? That's the question. The answer is, a person has to cry for a tragedy that happens to others more than what he cries for himself. Why? Why? Because it's a very big sgula that Hashem will cure you faster. If you're selfish, you worry only about your problems and you pray about yourself all the time, when the time comes, Hashem may accept your prayer. But if you cry for others, I cry that they will have children. Why don't you cry that you have children? You also don't have children. I cry they have children. Why? I live with my pain and sorrow. I have emunah in Hashem. Whatever Hashem wants, it's fine. I don't kill myself. So why you cry for him? Because he suffers from it. He doesn't have so much emunah. He kills himself. So I cry for him. What would happen? Hashem will answer you before even him, because you pray for him. The question is still remain. Why Yosef gave to Binyamin more than he gave to all the other brothers? Discrimination. Why you give in front of them to Binyamin more? The Chatam Sofer said like this. Amar Rabbi Yoshua ben Levi, Amocher avdo leovet kochavim. Someone sell your slave to an idol worshiper. Goy. Konsim oto ad mea bedamav. You give him a penalty. Big pian penalty. Why? Chazal say, the price of a slave back in the time when they had slavery is 30 kesef. We learn it from an ox who hit a Knani slave. 30 shekel will pay his Adonav. They have a set price. We see that when they sold Yosef to be a slave, the brother committed to pay 3,000 kesef. Why? Because you give a penalty 100 times more than the value of the slave if you sell him to an idol worshiper. Because now this slave has to be in the hand of a rasha, of a person who worships an idol. That's a tragedy for him. If you sell him to a Jew, the Jew convert him and teach him Torah and takes care of him, that's a price for him. You sell him to Ovet Kochavim, it's a disaster. So you get a penalty. How much? 100 times more. So 30 times 100, 3,000. Kevan, the brother, there were 10 brothers. Each one of them had to pay 300. 3,000 divided by 10. Each one of them has to pay 300. This is what Yosef gave penalty to all his brothers by the judgment. But Binyamin, that did not participate in his selling, he gave him 300 kesef, but he did not give it to the brothers. That means Yosef wanted to give them, but he rather give them the punishment in this world, because the Torah say that if you are punished in this world, you are lucky. You don't want to be punished in the next world, because over there everything is very, very big. Over there is very, very big. I basically finished, but I just want to tell you one last thing. When I told you in the first sentence of my lecture tonight, I told you that there are two ways to look at the Torah. From an eyes of a Talmid Chacham, a smart Jew, smart person, with brain in his head, with head on his shoulder, with legs on the ground, with stability, with depth, with experience of learning Torah, that's one way. Most of the people are not like that. Most of the people are empty head. No feet on the ground. No straight spine. No experience in learning Torah. And totally no depth.
Now I want you to see how two different individuals look at the same case in the Torah. When Yosef said to the brothers, Ani Yosef, Ahod Avi Chai, I'm Yosef. Is my father still alive? What's the question? We've been telling you about your father for an hour. Don't leave Binyamin here. It's going to break the heart of his father. So you already know he's alive. What are you asking me? Is my father still alive? Yosef said to them, I'm Yosef. After he kicked the Egyptians out, I'm your brother. They couldn't recognize him. He had beard. 30 years old now. He left 17. And now he dressed like a king. I'm Yosef. The Torah says they could not answer him because they got very, very scared. Very, very scared. There's a happy end to the story. They hugged, he hugged Binyamin, then he hugged them. Bring our father, I'll give you everything you want. So the Hollywood film finished with a happy end. This is how a person with no head on his shoulder look at the Torah. Stories. Happy end. Wow. Yosef and the brother made peace. Unity. Wonderful. How a Talmid Chacham look in the Torah? Biggest tragedy. A disaster. An earthquake, a shock. Look what Chazal say. Listen carefully and we finish with this. Oy lanu miyom adin. Oy to us from the judgment day. Oy lanu miyom atochecha. The day we will stand in front of Hashem. And the truth will be revealed about each one of us. In a court of heaven, all the stealing, all the lying, all the horrible things that we did, indoor, outdoor, behind the scene, front of the scene, it will all one day explode in our face. The brothers could not make a beep. They died from fear, from shame. HaKadosh Baruch Hu forced the souls back into their body. Be'ala. You know what Be'ala means? You cannot take the pain. That's Be'ala. Ve'efkati alechem Be'ala. You live with paranoia, panic attacks, shaking, vibration, crying, medication, sleeping in bed, 200 beats a minute. Wake up, what happened with you? I'm dying, oh my God. Like the people that saw the Twin Towers collapse in front of their eyes and people jump from the 80th floor in front of their eyes. That's what we're going to feel in a judgment day. Because we will realize that all the scamming and all the show-off and all the pretending, it's all now is going to be revealed. Not only that, we will find out that the things that we were sure that Hashem is owing, He owe us so much, it will explode in our face and we will actually realize there was a huge mistake. People who give money to reformed synagogues, when they realize what punishments they are going to get for it now. People who give money to synagogues that people come with the car on Shabbat, that there's no mechitza between the man and the woman, that the rabbi over there is a clown with ideology of goyim, like a professor in college, that never ever speak musar and tell everyone what a big tzaddikim they are, and you sponsor that place, and you think what a tzaddik I am. I'm sponsoring the shul for 30 years. Yes? Come and see your punishment. What? Punishment? Yeah, what? It's a circus, it's not a shul. Show one good thing that came out of that shul.
besides Lashon Hara and politics and fighting and kissing up to wicked people and breaking Shabbat and doing horrible things over there and no Musar and not one good speech in 30 years. How many good speakers you brought in to speak in a shul? Only liberal from the university. Only pro-gay, only pro-Arabs, only people that deny that the Torah is valid. Those are the speakers you brought into your shul. Who are the boards of directors that you put in the shul to run the show? One by one, wicked people. Come pay the price. Do you know what shock we're going to get? There's a lot of people with a beautiful beard that think they are minimum, each one of them is a Baba Sali. When they see what schools they send their children to, how they're going to pay the price for every sin their children do because they put them in public school. It's all going to become real in 1 minute. This is exactly, Chazal say, what happened to the brothers of Yosef in that moment. No happy end, no baloney, nothing. They realize every second of the last 20 years we lived in a lie. What a horrible mistake we made. They died from shame. Like the father that in a wedding in Israel, before the wedding end, the bag, back then people used to put all the checks and the cash in the bag, and somebody has to watch the bag. Today they have safes and all kinds of things, but back in time, 15 minutes before the wedding end, the bag with all the check and the cash is gone. The chatan and the kala, everyone is looking. They have to pay the owner of the catering place, to the band. What are we going to do? We counted on this money. They go police until 3 o'clock. Imagine what a terrible end to the wedding. They search everywhere, calling people, nothing. 3 weeks later, they got the video of the wedding. The entire family comes to see. Everybody sits in the living room. In Israel, it's a true story. It really happened. All of a sudden, the last 15 minutes of the wedding, the kala said to her husband, look, Moshe, this is the bag with all the gifts. They're still there. Maybe we'll get lucky to see who stole it. Then they see someone comes in from the side. They can't see the face. He picks up the bag, put everything, push it under his jacket. And then everybody in the living room heard the chair is falling on the floor. Boom! In Israel, the floor is it's stone, not like here, wood. Pah! Everyone turned. The father of the bride, heart attack, fainted. They look at the screen. He is the one who stole all the gift from his own daughter and son-in-law. Imagine the shame in front of 50 people, the family. This is not 1/1,000,000,000% of the shame of Mechalel Shabbat that will stand in front of Hashem. Or someone who put his children in public school and murdered their soul and made them goyim and marry the goyim. Do you know what it's going to be? Stand in front of Hashem? Forget Achshav, family, this. Okay, it's a big bushot. This is what Chazal said, Rabotai. No happy end, no baloney. There's no happy end here. It finished with a huge tragedy. Each one of these brothers was slaughtered in a horrible massacre. And what was the end of it? Oy lanu miyom adin, oy lanu miyom atochecha. Yosef, the youngest among the tribes. The brothers could not stand still when they got the rebuke from him. Lo yachlu la'anot oto ki nivalu mipanav. They got so scared from him. La'atid lavo, in a future to come, when HaKadosh Baruch Hu will come and rebuke each one and one of us. As it's written in Tehillim, Psalms, chapter 50, Ochichacha ve'erecha le'enecha. The time will come that I will rebuke you and set everything in order in front of you, everything you did in your life. As the Zohar says in Parashat Vayechi, once we die, we get permission to see everything we could not see when we were alive. Everything. why this happened to you, why you were sick, why you missed your shidduch, why you didn't get until age, you didn't get, not get married until age 30, why this, why that, why you got sick, all these things that you're wondering to yourself why, everything will be clear to the last, thinnest explanation. Al achat kama v'chama, Chazal say, the judgment day is the biggest punishment to the sins. It's ayom venora, it's horrible. It's kal v'chomer. If the brothers died from shame for one sin, imagine we have millions, what's going to happen? When a person see all the things that he did in his life, and this is the world of the truth over there, you cannot cover for it. This is the conclusion of Parashat Vayigash. No happy end, no nothing. It did not finish in a happy end. Why? Because the truth exploded in their face. And that's the Chazal said, this is the message for us. Chazal don't talk for nothing. That's the way we have to go. When you read in this coming Shabbat, when you leave the shul, you have to be shaking after reading it in the Torah. Psh. What's going to be with me? Wow. I'm already 40, I'm already 50, I'm already 70. Everyone with this problem. Soon I'm going to be out of here. How will I come to my father and the boys are not with me? When you come to see your God, the Torah says, don't come empty-handed. It's written pasuk in the Torah. Ba'alotcha lirot et Hashem Elokecha be'ar ha'bchira. Ish kematnat yado. Don't come with empty hands. Chazal say, what do you mean? Of course, I have to come with lots of mitzvot, lots of Torah. They are the only things that will save me. Not the Bentley, not the show-off, not the expensive clothes, not the every week a new watch. That's not going to save me. Not my friends who kissed up to me all my life. They won't save me. Nobody will save you. The only one who can save you is your Torah and your mitzvot. And I'm going to tell it to you for the 1,000 times. We are far away from fixing our mistakes and our sin. We are very far away. All of us. Most likely, unfortunately, based on the statistic, especially in this generation, we will not make the right necessary correction to our soul. I'm telling you already. Unfortunately, I'm sorry I have to say it. But let's try to be realistic. We are not growing already for 20 years. We're not becoming better Talmidei Chachamim. We do not become better people. We did not get rid of our ego and anger and selfishness and laziness and. We don't see any improvement in 20 years. Most of my Baalei Teshuva from 20 years ago, besides 10% of them went to yeshivot and became serious learners, standing in one place for 20 years. And some of them even went back sometimes. No progress. Same thing. Still with the jeans, still with the hole, still with the little quarter yarmulke, still with the gel in the hair, still with all the show-off, still with 20 seconds davening. Same thing. Still cursing, still not honest in the business, still in Shabbat waiting with a cigarette on his hair, on his ear. Wow, wow. 5, 4, 3. Wow, wow. That's not how you make it to the right place in heaven. So ask me, so what, should we give up? We have one way out. One way out. One way out. That's it. Just one way out. Of course, we will try to do tshuva and try to learn more Torah and to give tzedakah. Of course, we will try. But there's only one thing will save us. Do you know what? How many Jewish souls we will be able to save in our lifetime? With our mouth, with our house, with our body, and with our money. Most people don't know how to talk. And most people don't have a house for lectures. And most people, not everyone knows how to do kiruv or to save souls. But everyone can give money. Even poor people.
And people that don't have money, they can convince rich people to give money. And money does the job. Money, it's in Hebrew, it's called blood. It saves life. Just like you have blood transfusion, money, CDs, USBs, books, things like these, wake up a lot of people to do tshuva. One of the people you made become religious from your money became a rabbi. He teach student, he teach gemara, he teach in yeshiva, he open yeshiva, he writes books. Rav Ovadia Yosef left the yeshiva when he was a kid. His father, Yaakov, told him, Ovadia, come help me in a grocery store. I can't walk by myself. 3 days he did not go to yeshiva. The Rosh Yeshiva, Rav Ezra Atiyah, where is the boy Ovadia? Where is he? Maybe he's sick. He went to the house. The wife said, no, he's not sick. He's walking by the grocery store. That's how it used to be, Rabotai. People were very poor. His father had a little grocery, size of the little KitchenAid over there. He came, he said, what do you do, Rabbi Yaakov? Why the boy is not in yeshiva? I'm sorry, I can't, I need help here. I'll cut the cheese, let him go back to yeshiva. I'll come help you every day. He meant it. What do you think happened? He said, okay, fine, Ovadia, go to the yeshiva, you come help me. But after 5 minutes, people came and saw the most important chacham in Yerushalayim, Rav Ezra Atiyah, that all the big Sfaradi rabbis of this generation came out of his hand. All. Without him, I don't think the Sfaradim would have anything in the world. They say to Rabbi Yaakov, you're letting the big chacham cutting cheese? This is the respect you have for the Torah? After 1 hour, I'm sorry, chacham. Go, I'm sorry, please, forgive me. Imagine if he did not go that day. What would happen with his Ovadia? What would happen to him? He have one brother, not religious. Went off the derech. Naim, I think his name was. Iraqi. You look at him like in a shuk. You know this Iraqi that sit in a shuk and play sheshbesh and have this necklace? They both came from the same place. If Rav Ezra Atiyah would not go that day, Ovadia Yosef would be like his brother. One of the Iraqim in a shuk who play sheshbesh. But he saved his soul. What do you think happened? All the Torah of more than 1 million Baalei Tshuva in Israel that learn in his books goes to his file every day, to his bank account in Shamayim. Every day. You know, there used to be a Rav in Eretz Israel, Rav Kook. He was the first Zionist religious rabbi, Rav Kook. He had a righteous wife. One day she was standing by her kitchen window and she see workers working in a field nearby. She decided to go bring them some water. Cold water in Israel, it's hot. When she gave them water, she saw one of them is very depressed. Sir, are you okay? Everything okay? No, I'm not in a good mood. Why? They took my son today to a place called Cubits. I just came from Morocco. I don't know what kibbutz mean. I didn't know what it means. They told me it's a good place, but now the people told me it's a very bad place. They're not religious over there. I'm so worried about my son. I don't even know what to do. She said to him, where is this? He told her the name. Where is it? It's very far. Tell me, she asked, if I will go to that kibbutz, what's the name of your son? She said. His name is Reuven. If I go to your son and I ask him to come with me and I'll bring him to my husband's yeshiva to sit over there, will he agree? He said, of course, he loves to learn Torah so much. In Morocco, we learn all the time. We came here, they made me a worker in a field. Okay, don't worry, I'll go there. She took a few buses. I'm talking to you over 60 years ago, this story. 50 years ago, to be more precise. She took buses. She went to that kibbutz. Zionist, anti-religion,
communist kibbutz who destroyed thousands of Jewish souls, forced them to leave the Torah and become goyim. They destroyed Israel, these kibbutzim and moshavim. She arrived to the place, I'm looking for this boy, Reuven. Reuven, here is the boy. Reuven, your father sent me. I want to take you to yeshiva. You happy here? No, it's bad here. Nobody make bracha. People here not Jewish. You want to come with me? I'll take you to yeshiva of my husband? Of course. Okay, pack your stuff. She took him and she brought him to the yeshiva. Who was this Reuven? The first rabbi in Israel who started the tshuva revolution, the movement of repentance. We all owe him our life, all of us. Without him, probably nobody would know about this concept of taking secular Jews and turn them into religious Jews. He started that 50 years ago, before I was even born. Rav Reuven Elbaz, Rosh Yeshivat Or HaChaim, he has yeshiva in Yerushalayim, 8 floors, hundreds of Baalei Tshuva. 200 institutions he has. Kindergarten, school for girls, yeshivot, synagogues. 200 institutions. One of the most charming, welcoming person in this earth. If you saw my video with him when I went to his office, how he treat a person like he's the king of the world. And he wrote to me, Baruch Hashem, I had the zchut, wonderful dedication in my book. We became friendly over the years because I had the zchut to send him many, many talmidim to the yeshiva. So Rav Reuven Elbaz, if the Rabbanit Cook will not go to save him that day, he would be one of the anti-Torah Tzionim today, probably a minister in a Knesset or something like this that fight the Torah and kill everything religious. But she took one day of her life with buses and she saved the boy. And she brought him to Torah and he became the pioneer. The pioneer of the tshuva movement. Everyone who came later on learned from him the concept. That there is such a thing to talk to secular people, bring them for Shabbat and give them speeches and they become Shomrei Shabbat. He started everything. Imagine the reward of this rabbanit. One day of effort. But it doesn't matter what she did in the rest of her life. Just this alone. This alone. Endless trillions of mitzvot goes to her account every year. Trillions. Rachel, the wife of Rabbi Akiva, 24 years of suffering that her husband will learn Torah and teach Torah. When they came back and he was 64 years old, she did not see him for 24 years. What's the first sentence Rabbi Akiva said when she walked in? All our Torah combined belongs to her. You do the math. 24 years of learning of 24,000 students. Torah in a very high level, not like today. Everything goes to her. And what did she do? Sat for 24 years and look at straw around her. She lived in a house made from straw. No electric, no nothing. So poor! That Hashem sent someone, Eliyahu Navi, dressed like a poor man and ask her, do you have maybe to give me some straw? I'm so poor, you have a lot of straw. I don't even have straw. Of course, take straw. Hashem wanted to ease her pain because she grew up as a religious girl. Her father was the richest guy in Israel. She left the religion, she left the wealth and followed the religion. And when he came back after 24 years, Hashem sent Eliyahu Navi to make her feel good because he felt that she's about to break from how much suffering she's going through, to send Rabbi Akiva to learn Torah. Age 40, he did not know Aleph Bet. And he became the most legendary rabbi in the history of the Jewish nation. Somebody asks you, who is the biggest Jew ever lived and will ever live? The answer is Rabbi Akiva. Why not Moshe Rabbeinu? Why? Because Moshe Rabbeinu got everything from Hashem in a CD. Hashem put CD in his head. In 40 days, cannot teach what Moshe knew. Rabbi Akiva got it on his own effort. Against all odds.
started age 40, went to kindergarten to learn Aleph Bet. Everybody is 5 years old and a man 40 years old sitting and learning Aleph, Bet, Gimel. And what happened in the end? Moshe Rabbeinu said, he saw him in a vision. You have such a Jew and you gave the Torah by me? This is how he died? Hashem said to Moshe, don't question me. With the righteous people, I'm very strict with the judgment. Why? Because they're in a very high level. מדקדקים הצדיקים כחוט השערה. We'll see you בעזרת השם next Monday, 8 o'clock. ברוך אדוני לעולם. אמן ואמן. Anyone wants to say קדיש? רבי חנניה בן הקשיא אומר, רצה הקדוש ברוך הוא לזכות.